You can support In the Past Lane with as little as $1 a month. Just go to the support page at our website, inthepastlane.com. Thanks. In 1893, millions of Americans headed to the World's Fair in Chicago. There they found exhibitions on art, history, and technology, all presented in a series of dazzling white buildings that comprised the White City. Also on display were exhibitions featuring so-called exotic primitive peoples from deepest, darkest Africa, wearing animal skins and holding objects like spears. It was essentially an anthropology zoo that catered to the racism of the day, confirming associations of dark skin with backwardness and savagery. Millions came to gawk, point, and snap photos. But there's more. All the people in those exhibits were African Americans, local residents of Chicago hired to perform primitiveness. That's right, it was incredibly racist and totally fake. You are listening to In the Past Lane, the podcast about history and why it matters.
We, the people of the United States, in order to form a more
perfect huddled union, masses yearning to breathe
consider
free.
Consider that we shall be as a city upon a hill.
That all men and women are created equal.
Give me liberty or give me death.
Nobody's free until everybody's free.
The government of the people, by the people, for the people, shall not perish from the earth.
History matters because it's not just about the past. History's about us, here and now. It explains the world we live in and why things are the way they are. And history gives us insights into how to achieve a more just, peaceful, and prosperous future. So people, let's do this. Hi, everyone. Welcome to In the Past Lane, the podcast about history and why it matters. I'm host Edward T. O'Donnell, your historian at large, and this is In the Past Lane, episode 62, in which we take a deep dive into the history of bunk. That's right, the role of frauds, scams, lies, and fakery in American history. We are coming to you this week from the Bigfoot Studios, located in central Massachusetts. You can learn more about me, this podcast, and our guests at our website, inthepastlane.com, and on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and YouTube. Making sure no one pulls a fast one on us is our ever-vigilant executive producer, Lulu Spencer. So, what's happening in the Past Lane this week? Well, I'm on the road again. I'm in Sacramento for the annual conference of the Organization of American Historians. I'll be on a panel of historians who, wait for it, are podcasters. They include Graham Peck of St. Xavier University. He hosts a podcast that explores the life of Catherine McCauley, an Irish religious sister who founded the Sisters of Mercy. Also on the panel, Nicole Hemmer of the Woodrow Wilson Center for Public Affairs. She's the host of the podcast, Past Present. Some of you may recall that Nikki was a guest on In the Past Lane, episode 18, talking about her book, Messengers of the Right, on the history of the rise of right-wing media. Also on the panel is Julie Golia of the Brooklyn Historical Society. She's the co-host of Flatbush in Maine, a podcast about all things Brooklyn. And last but not least is Liz Covart of the Omohundro Institute. She's also the host of the podcast, Ben Franklin's World. I'll be sure to post links to all these podcasts on our show page for this episode. If you're in Sacramento, our panel is happening on Saturday, April 14th at 10 a.m. We also have a big announcement. Drum roll, please, Lulu. Yeah, I didn't think so. Anyway, big news. In the Past Lane now has merch. If you want an In the Past Lane t-shirt, hoodie, mug, phone case, stickers, you name it, you'll find them at TeePublic. That's T-E-E. Public. Go to teepublic.com/inthepastlanepodcast2018. You'll even find some fun stuff, like t-shirts with pithy quotes about history, or my personal favorite that says, Historians Against History Repeating Itself. Go take a look and let me know what you think. Finally, thanks to the newest patrons of this podcast, David G., Kyle M., Amber T., and Melanie S. Thank you so much for your support. These folks have pledged financial support at either Patreon or PayPal, all of which goes to cover the costs of making this podcast. So if you're interested in helping out, just go to our support page at inthepastlane.com. Thanks. Okay, time to get to our main feature today, my interview with Kevin Young about his new book, Bunk, The Rise of Hoaxes, Humbugs, Plagiarists, Phonies, Post-Facts, and Fake News. Okay, people, ignore that carnival barker. Time to hop in and get going. Your journey in the Past Lane begins now. Who doesn't love a good scam? or a clever bit of fakery. I certainly do. And my personal favorite from U.S. history is the Cardiff Giant scam of 1869. Here's how this one went down. On October 16, 1869, two workmen were digging a well on an upstate New York farm in the small town of Cardiff when they made a startling discovery, what appeared to be the petrified remains of an ancient man. That alone would have been cause for great public interest. But what made this discovery particularly sensational was the size of the man. He was a giant, 10 feet 4 inches tall, and he lay in a position that suggested he'd been stricken and died in great pain. When news of this intriguing discovery made its way into the national media, thousands of people began flocking to upstate New York to get a glimpse of the Cardiff Giant. Speculation as to the giant's origins ran rampant. The general public and several notable archaeologists and experts declared the giant a genuine fossil. Others thought it might be an ancient statue from some lost civilization like Easter Island. The owner of the farm where the discovery was made was George Hull. At first, he seemed annoyed by all the fuss. But he then quickly built a tent over the giant and began charging 50 cents admission. Within a week, he'd cleared an astonishing sum of $10,000, and the crowds just kept on growing. Before long, P.T. Barnum, the famous showman, offered to buy the giant for $50,000, but George Hull turned him down. Undeterred, Barnum commissioned a sculptor to make him his own petrified giant man, which he then put on exhibition in Brooklyn. For a price, of course. George Hull, the owner of the original Cardiff Giant, then sued Barnum. But P.T. Barnum won in court, after successfully claiming that he was only guilty of exhibiting a fake of a fake. Months later, as evidence accumulated that the Cardiff Giant was a sculpture of recent origin, the truth finally came out. The farmer, George Hull, had staged the whole thing. Apparently, he had created the Cardiff Giant for two reasons. First, he wanted to embarrass and expose fundamentalist Christian preachers who insisted the Bible be taken literally, including the line, "Giants once walked the earth." And second, George Hull wanted to make money off the gullible American public. So, he commissioned a sculptor in Chicago to make the giant. Then he had it secretly transported by train to Cardiff, New York, whereupon, under the cover of darkness, he buried it. Then he waited a year before hiring the two men to dig a well right over the spot where the giant rested. And so it was that the Cardiff Giant became an entry in the Encyclopedia of Bunk. All right, coming up in a minute, my conversation with Kevin Young about all manner of fraud, flimflam, and fakery, starting with the moon hoax, which began in 1835, when the New York Sun published a series of sensational stories about the discovery, via high-powered telescope, of a thriving society of strange human-like creatures living on the moon. Ah yes, fake news has a long history.
You are listening to In the Past Lane, the podcast about history and why it matters.
Okay, back at In the Past Lane, Edward T. O'Donnell, your historian at large. And with me now is Kevin Young. Kevin Young is a poet, literary critic, and a writer. He's also the director of the New York Public Library's Schomburg Center for Research in Black Culture and the poetry editor at The New Yorker. Kevin is here today to talk to us about his newest book, Bunk, The Rise of Hoaxes, Humbugs, Plagiarists, Phonies, Post-Facts, and Fake News. Kevin Young, welcome to In the Past Lane.
Thanks for having me.
Great. Well, my first question is really looking at the kind of taking a macro level look at the book itself. I mean, your career is pretty wide-ranging and diverse, and I think a lot of people know you as a poet. And in fact, you're now the poetry editor at The New Yorker. And you also have a position at the Schomburg Center, which is a research library connected with the New York Public Library. You've written literary criticism, so nonfiction is not foreign to you. But this seems like such an interesting plunge for you. Started 5 or 6 years ago, this book on hoaxes and scams and cons in American history. How did you decide that this was going to be your first take on a work of history with this particular topic?
Well, I tried hard not to write a history. I tried to write it many different ways in a way. But it really became a history when I realized that Barnum, who was always in the story, was really the start of the story and told us something about American life and character. And that by starting with him as kind of a first character, he told us a lot about our current day. And, you know, I had previously written about lying as a kind of generative force. And, you know, there's an African-American tradition of calling folk tales lies. Mm-hmm. And I jumped off from that to think about improvisation and black life. And once I finished that book called The Gray Album, I started thinking about the bad side of lies and started tracing them through history, and it ended up, of course, being a big book because there's a lot of liars.
Turns out it's a central part of American culture going way, way back, and I guess you had to decide to start somewhere. And so you do start in the early 19th century, and one of the first hoaxes that you talk about is the moon hoax. This is one that comes to light in the 1830s, and it's a product very much of the era of this emerging thing called the penny press and other factors. So tell us about the moon hoax and how this gets us started on this track of understanding Americans' fixation with hoaxes and willingness to be taken in by them to a certain point, and also what cultural values and cultural biases that they expose.
Yeah, I mean, I think the moon hoax is a classic one. You kind of have to think about it. And I tried to think about it in new ways. It certainly, with the penny press, it's kind of tied intricately together. Papers used to be a nickel, and then suddenly there's the advent of a paper that's a penny. And suddenly the idea of speaking to the common man and different kind of factions almost arose quite quickly in competing penny papers. And that, I think, also was fueled by hoaxes and the moon hoax, which ran in the New York Sun, ironically, mm-hmm. You know, charted the supposed discovery by an actual astronomer, Herschel, of life on the moon. And what I tried to think about is both what audiences might have thought. You know, did they believe this? And some did. Or did they were they entertained by it? How did they regard it? And I came to think of it as much like something like reality TV, mm-hmm. where people sort of know it's fake or know it's constructed in some way, but also take pleasure in it and try to glean something real from it or some kind of real pleasure, let's say. But, you know, people did argue over these possibilities. And I think one of the reasons it worked is, A, it was cleverly written,
right,
the moon hoax, but B, it was also constructed as a kind of uncovering life on the moon in ways that I think we imagined life on Earth to be. It was sort of neatly and tidily arranged. And it was also pretty hierarchical.
Right. The society they describe is very loaded with ideas that actually come from planet Earth. Tell us about that.
Right, right. Yeah, I think it's filled with race in many ways. And you know, there's sort of higher race and class of beings on the Earth. There's man-bats. There's other figures. There's biped mm-hmm. beavers, which are some of my favorites. And people kind of lump them all together when they talk about it. And really, I think that hierarchical sense, which is very much almost like the Book of Genesis or something, where, you know, there's the animals, right, and then life sort of evolves, and then there's this higher form. And of course, at the time, we're right about to start, you know, arguments over polygenesis and sort of racist notions of eugenics that come around in the same time. But I was really interested in the ways that the technology, the penny press, influenced sort of what we saw and you know, also populated or made popular, I should say, the hoaxes that came to be. And in many ways, I think that's like the internet for us, where it also promised a kind of democratic freedom and, you know, access to people that might not have access to information. But it was also, and still is, flooded with hoaxes and falsehoods.
Right. It's a great opportunity for opportunists. Well, and speaking of opportunists, in the Opportunist Hall of Fame, I think at the headliner is P.T. Barnum, who most people at least are familiar with the name and associate him with, you know, the circus. But primarily in the 19th century, he's really a showman exhibiting oddities and curiosities and sensationalisms and exoticisms in his, what he called, like to call, a museum. So he offers this sort of veneer of science and anthropology.
Sure.
But then it's all about charging admission and whipping up stories about it. So tell us about P.T. Barnum, where he comes from, and how he really becomes a master of this emerging genre of hoaxes and cons.
He was the greatest showman of the age. You know, he, in fact, I think, invented or at least codified some of the things that were happening already in terms of the con. I mean, the very term con artist is an American term, and I think Barnum brought to bear, you know, a professionalism and what he calls humbug. And I love his definition of humbug, because it's really about giving a good show. It's not simply about faking someone. That's not necessarily, you know, that if you fake someone badly, that is a crime. But he's saying, like, if you give someone a good show and pretend to be what he calls the cannibal king, then, you know, that's okay. And people aren't going to call that. Audiences accept that.
Right. The audiences, yeah, they're sort of in on the joke. There's this understanding that if you're going to see the Fiji mermaid, it's probably not a real Fiji mermaid. But maybe it is and maybe it isn't. And even if it seems as though nobody really storms out of these exhibits saying that's an absolute, you know, fraud. They seem sort of entertained by the fact that they're being you know, had in a way. Like you say, almost like reality TV, most people in the rational part of their brain know that it's completely constructed, but that they're willing to go along with it because it is entertaining and there are these little dramas within it.
Sure. And I think Barnum, what is brilliant about him is he taps into the sort of deep divisions and questions people have. He reframes them as history, but he also reframes them as questions. He's sort of like, well, I don't know. You're the expert. You decide for yourself. And it's a very American principle, mm-hmm. I think, that also accompanies the penny press. The troubling part is, you know, toward the, not even the end, he lived a long time, but in 1860, he showed what is it, ?
Right.
And the it was capitalized. And, you know, I talk about that hoax in terms of his show of race and evolution. This is just right after Origin of the Species, and here he is showing a black man who he pretended to be the missing link. And what does that mean? And it shapes not just our view of this one particular individual who obviously wasn't anything Barnum said he was, or rather asked, was he? But instead, it sort of shapes our view of race as a whole and black people. And it really started me thinking about the ways that, you know, the hoax is always dependent on race, or often, if not always. And race is also a kind of hoax.
Yeah, and it's interesting that one of the things that you point out is that so many of these hoaxes, some of them are just simply one-off oddities, but so many of them are really reflections of social anxieties and social fears and fears about or questions about race and about culture and about hierarchy and so forth. And that story of William Johnson, he's the person who was given the name Old Zip, or simply the exhibit, I guess it was called What Is It? And this is a, you know, showing him as this missing link primitive was obviously a reflection of the raging debates about slavery, about race, about equality that really marked the mid-19th century. And there are other aspects of Barnum that touch on race as well, like Joyce Heth and others. Tell us a little bit more about this theme of race that runs through a lot of his exhibits.
Well, Joyce Heth, he showed in 1835, and I'm really interested in the ways that Joyce Heth, who was shown by Barnum and said to be George Washington's nursemaid, which would have made her 161 years old, a fact, quote unquote, he trumpeted.
Mm-hmm.
And I think the troubling thing about it is not just that, you know, what people wanted from her, which is somewhat interesting. They wanted this connection to one of the founding fathers, if not the founding father, and they sought it in her. And I think that's really interesting. And it gets at some of our needs to believe a history, especially as a young nation, an established one. And at the same time, Barnum probably enslaved her, probably had bought her. He, when she died, he then charged admission to her autopsy in a medical theater and wrote up the discovery, which wasn't a discovery, but that she wasn't actually 161, but she was sort of normal advanced age, to make money and also make more of the hoax itself. And so it's a troubling incident, I think, but it's also what kicks off his career.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to think about the ways that in this very same year as the moon hoax, but also as I talk about in the book, the invention of blackface and these other American ideas, we have this Joyce Heth hoax.
Right. And blackface is that other part of the story. You talk about the rise of the penny press, the rise of Barnum and exhibitionism, and then minstrelsy is just all the rage. It's really the number one form of popular entertainment in the mid-19th century. And it's central to it is this idea of white characters putting on blackface and showing to a white audience what black people are really about and what they're really like and what their nature is and so forth. And this is, of course, all against the backdrop of a raging debate about slavery and abolition and so forth. So how does blackface fit into it as a form of hoax?
Well, I could talk about it all day. but, you know, I think there's this, you know, the whole book, I think, thinks about some of these ideas in different ways. And of course, blackface persists much longer than many people think. I was teaching a class and a graduate student said, well, you know, blackface ended in whatever, like 1900. I said, oh, that's not true. I like went down to my office and brought her a picture of, you know, Bing Crosby and blackface, and you know, it certainly persisted.
Al Jolson,
yeah, but he's in the 20s at least. You can kind of say, oh, it's a while ago, but you start to see Judy Garland in blackface, and you're like, hey, yeah, you start to realize its persistence, and it really only goes away.
Mm-hmm.
And as a popular medium, I mean, most high schools would have a blackface show, white high schools, I should say.
Yes,
and here we are now with a figure like Rachel Dolezal, who is the woman who pretended to be black and not only pretended, darkened her skin and changed her hair and was the head of a chapter of the NAACP in Washington State. So, you know, what is it all about? And I try to tease out sort of the misperception that is blackface. And it still persists and is a not unfamiliar misperception. It's one that I think even governs notions of blackness more broadly.
Right.
And the hoax really regularly plays on it. And one of the fascinating things is all these sort of imposters that come up in the book who especially say native, pretend to be native.
Right.
And what is that about? Why does that persist? And, you know, there were many outed last summer when the book was already in print, you know, so it became this kind of ongoing thing. And I realized both that we were in a worse cycle of hoaxing, and I was trying to understand that, why. And at the same time, you know, it just kept going. I realized I could keep going and adding to this book, so I needed to finally get it out there and be read.
There's a great line from F. Scott Fitzgerald says, you never finish a book. Your editor just eventually yanks it out of your hands and publishes it. So I think that's right. All books have to come to an end at some point.
Sure. Well, one hopes. I mean, I very much realized that. And so I was glad I was, you know, myself was like, we got to finish this. It's got to be done.
So. Yeah. Well, another figure that doesn't appear super large in the book, but he seems like in some ways the successor to P.T. Barnum in terms of telling American stories and impersonating certain moments in history, which is Buffalo Bill. You know, he comes along in the 1880s and has a career into the early 20th century, and then basically all of his ideas go right into Western movies and things. And there's all kinds of elements of race and performance, and because he went to great pains in his Wild West show in the late 19th and early 20th century to say these are real Indians.
Right.
And in fact, many of them were. They were hired to perform these kind of ritual attacks on wagon trains and to do ceremonial dances and so forth. And so there's a lot of that. I mean, audiences know that they're not seeing a train robbery or an attack on a wagon train when they go to see Buffalo Bill, but it has that feeling of realness.
Yeah.
This, you know, that I think people buy into. And in the same way, it's sort of the precursor to reality TV in a lot of ways.
Sure. Well, and, you know, there's some really interesting writing about Buffalo Bill and thinking about the ways that he constructed hierarchy too. I mean, he, by the end, was showing a kind of almost evolutionary show where it would start with people in the forest foraging for food. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, the kind of triumphant moment was him as the kind of figure, the ultimate man. And he kind of had these figures of horsemanship and different things along the way, but it was very clearly pointing in one direction of sort of progress and westward ho.
Yep.
And, you know, part of his even name, of course, comes not from, you know, loving buffalo, but from killing lots of them.
Right.
And so it's a fascinating show. And I'm also fascinated with world fairs, and he had a really interesting exhibition outside of the Chicago one. So
yeah, the Chicago one is very important, and you note a number of things about the, you know, the World's Fair. One is that it's where all kinds of race is put on display. It's where America meets Aunt Jemima, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, that's Jemima's debut.
Yeah, and there's their displays of things posing as anthropology, where there are exhibitions of Africans from the deepest, darkest jungles of Africa. And it turns out that they're actually just people, African-Americans from Chicago, who had been hired to put on these costumes.
And Fijians, I think that was a common theme that Barnum tips to, from the Fiji mermaid, which you mentioned, mm-hmm. to actual Fijians, some of whom were actually Fijian.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, there was a lot of that in that World's Fair.
Yeah, and also it's an interesting moment in terms of the history of African Americans in the U.S. That's also when people like Frederick Douglass and others protest outside of that fair because they do not like the way in which the absence of African American culture in many ways, but then also this kind of cartoonish performance stuff that's also there. It's a very interesting moment of early civil rights protest.
Absolutely.
By such a central figure like Frederick Douglass. Incidentally, I was just interested, you know, to notice thinking about hoaxing and such in the mid-19th century, Douglass came to mind. And I always ask my students when they always read this first year course I teach, they always start with Douglass. And at a certain point, I say, hey, I'll turn to the title page. And we focus on the fact that it's, you know, the narrative of the life of Frederick Douglass as written by himself. And I say, why do you think they would do that? And it occurs, you know, that this, your book sort of accentuates my hunch on why that is, which is that this was such a presumption that it was impossible for a freed slave to write such an eloquent and compelling story that they actually had to put it on the cover to say, oh, yes, he did, in fact, write it.
Oh, of course, yeah.
In some ways, it wasn't until he went on the road and began to speak before live audiences that people became convinced that he was the real deal. It's an interesting connection point with this broader theme of hoaxing and doubting and questioning people's credentials all the way up to birtherism,
right.
Which you delve into in your book as sort of the modern version of some of this.
Well, I mean, I think that now it isn't just that people are hoaxing about race. It's also race is the reason to accuse someone of hoaxing. And that's a really strange thing. I mean, and it underpins sort of fake news and all these kind of epithets that have come up to us recently. But then, as we can see in my book, are old as the country.
Right. You cite a document from 1917 that doesn't quite use the word fake news, but fake stories in journalism or fakes, journalistic fakes. So we've been talking about moon hoax type stories in journalism for a long, long time. But in some ways, it seems to me that we're in a different moment as far as what constitutes fake news today, or at least, you know, the purpose behind it. You know, there's a big difference between Pizzagate in recent times, which is a classic sort of, you know, quintessential fake news story, which had really nearly deadly consequences, and something like the moon hoax, which was, in essence, kind of a harmless stunt to sell newspapers and generate interest. So what is that difference? Hoaxing seems to have changed over time.
Yeah. I mean, I think both are true. I mean, I think that there's more to the moon hoax. I think that people are working out in that hoax, in believing it or not believing it or arguing about it, something about America and something about race. And indeed, something about slavery.
Yeah, so it is connected to those real and important issues of the day.
Sure. It also then, today, I do think the hoax has gotten worse, and it's also become more invested in the tragic. So I do think that's a change in the hoax that I explore in the book. Like, why now is the hoax really focused on horror? And Pizzagate wouldn't have been believed had the story been, well, there's this pizza place where kids are revered and things are great. You know, the reason it was sort of passed around and in its absurdity, right, as there's like a pedophilia ring there led by presidential candidates, is because we want to believe the worst. And I think that part of us wanting to believe the worst about each other is really the troubling, I wouldn't call it an advance, but a change in the hoax.
Right. But there is also, you know, along with that form of con and hoax, there are other forms that do remind us more of the 19th century. And I guess one question, sort of overarching question, is, do you think that hoaxing and cons and hustles of this sort that we've been talking about and that you write extensively about in the book, that these are somehow uniquely American or quintessentially American? Obviously, they're hoaxes in other societies, but there's something really powerful about hoaxes in American culture. Is there something about our society that makes us obsess about them and buy into them more so than most?
I mean, I think we have a culture of reinvention and a sort of notion of that I think hoaxing both plays on and plays with.
Sort of the Jay Gatsby factor.
Yeah, I mean, Gatsby is a fascinating, you know, I really tried to write about a million words or pages on Gatsby, which not all of it made it in there, but because I do think he's a quintessential American figure, one of reinvention. But the question becomes, you know, like Don Draper or somebody,
right,
in Mad Men, you know, is that the price of that reinvention, life and death, or an existence that's emptied out? And I think that's the worry and the sort of challenge and thrill, but also the price. But I also think that it's not just a sense of fluid identity. I also think there's a sense of history. And often in the early sets of hoaxes in the 19th century, say, it's to kind of honor by faking a history that isn't there yet. And so by creating a noble history or a connection to sort of an originating force, one of the other figures that Barnum used was the Circassian beauty thing he made up that's tied to sort of notions of Caucasianness and beauty, but they look like sort of light-skinned black women with afros. So it's this kind of real interesting mix of race and a wish, and, you know, even the story of Caucasianness is a fabrication. So it really starts to think about how the history is faked, and not just, you know, individual history, but sort of big H history.
I wonder also about the sort of culture of hoaxing and reinvention, which you mentioned, which really is a central American ideal of pulling oneself up by one's bootstraps, but also turning into something completely different. It's there in Gatsby. It's there in, you know, Mark Twain and Huck Finn. And it's also in that the broad story of immigration. I mean, immigration is ultimately a story of reinvention. You leave one place and come to another. And if you read a lot of immigrant letters, which I do in part of my work, they are just filled with half-truths about what's really happening in America and why everybody should come over, you know, talking about eating steak dinners twice a day and things. And they're not totally, you know, false, but they're grand exaggerations, all designed in this case to bring the rest of the family over because it's kind of lonely to be you know, from Poland and, you know, from your Polish village living in Chicago. You want everybody else to come on over. And I wonder if that's another thread in this thing, which connects right up to the present day.
Well, I mean, it ties us back a little bit to blackface because certainly by the end of the 19th century, blackface was really dominated by immigrants and, quote, ethnic whites who I think were adopted blackface because it was the fastest way to become an American, you know? And
yes,
it's a fascinating idea that this figure that's essentially American, the African-American, but also sort of excluded is certainly from the stage and from certain aspects of society is the route to becoming fitting in. And I think that's, there's a lot there. I've written about it in different contexts, but in this book, I was really interested in the ways that say this racial impostures or people who decided to become native, it was as much about whiteness as it was about nativeness. And it's certainly about a narrow notion of what Native Americans might be or do. And I try to explore that. And I try to think about the ways that telling someone else's story, which is often some, one of the reasons hoaxers give, why that erases that story. It's not really a form of advocacy after all.
Right. Imposters, I think one is it Old Crow, who's the figure from the early 20th century?
Oh, Gray Owl.
Talk about Gray Owl, I'm sorry. I don't know why
Old Crow, is that the drink?
Yeah, probably. One of those. I'm scanning my handwritten notes here. Yeah, so Gray Owl is one of these figures who poses as a Native American. And that's a really fascinating thing, again, connected to capital H history, which is that in the 19th century, almost nobody wants to pose as an Indian or Native American because they're the enemy. They're the you know, impediment to progress. And as soon as that conquest of the West is completed, we start naming places with Indian names. You start seeing Native Americans showing up in advertising and a lot of
sports teams.
Yeah, romantic literature about Native Americans. And then this fascination with the authentic, you know, what could be more authentic than a Native American? And it turns out most of the people who become famous as Native Americans, either in Hollywood or on the stage, are these posers, these people that do that right down to the advertisement that I remember from the 1970s, which was the public service announcement about
Keep America Beautiful.
Yeah, and the Native American in his canoe going down this garbage-strewn river and shedding a tear, and it's such a powerful ad, and it turns out he's just some, I don't know what his ultimate background was, but he's certainly not Native American.
Yeah,
convinced a lot of people that way.
Yeah, his name was Iron Eyes Cody, or the name he used. Yeah, and he fooled a lot of people, I think. You know, I certainly remember that ad, which ran for years, and it was very popular. And I say in the book, the tagline, I think, is one we can think of in terms of the hoax more broadly, which is people create pollution, people can stop it. We are hoaxing each other. How do we stop from hoaxing? How do we, catch hoaxes sooner and not fall for the false? And I think it can be difficult, but I also think the danger is not just to the truth, which I think we see sort of daily, but also to the imagination and to the idea that something made up can inspire you, can change you, and it needn't be true. And there's a kind of reflex, autobiographical notion that, well, if something makes me feel something, it must be true in the factual sense. And the truth is that art has long done that and been made up and magical and mystical in certain senses. And why are we resistant to that now? Why do we want our stories to be true? Why is that more moving than Gatsby?
Right. And that's why memoir is such a problematic category these days. It's all over the, there's so many memoirs being published. But as you note the often coming with these incredible disclaimers up front about how these are events as I remember them, sort of, and memory can, you know, and then there are these, you know, now famous examples, James Frey, A Million Little Pieces, and many others who've not just massaged the facts, but basically made things up. And it's a, like you say, it's a, you know, those would work as works of fiction.
Well, in his case, it's fascinating because what happened, and he talked about this on Oprah when he came back, is that he chopped it as a novel, which I had heard, and no one would buy it. So slap memoir on it, and there you have it.
There you have it. It has more grit, more power. At least that's for the perception of the publishers. And then, of course, everybody reads it. And some of these stories, like there's that fake Holocaust memoir that you cite about, you know, a Holocaust survivor being raised by wolves, you know, and you look at that now and you say, how did anybody believe that out of the gate? But people did enough. And then as soon as it's exposed, there's the corresponding outrage. You know, how dare you try to fool us? But in fact, most people were sort of along for the ride. It's an interesting dynamic.
Well, and I think I try to understand not just why we deceive, but why we believe, and what is it about the hoax that is attractive to us? Mm-hmm. And I think it changes, but I think it does get at these deep divisions in our culture. Race, gender, I think sometimes class comes in. Mm-hmm. But I was struck over and over again by the ways that race played into even the most seemingly innocuous hoaxes.
I mean, you're talking about the most contemporary ones or the ones that we've been talking about historically?
Yes, both. Even to the present day. I mean, even something like James Frey, you know, one of his lies is that he was in prison for a time, you know, for months. In fact, he was mm-hmm. in jail for a couple hours. Right. And in this prison, he writes about, you know, teaching a black prisoner to read and all this kind of, I don't even know what to call it politely. And, you know, there's a whole sequel about his time in prison, you know, beyond A Million Little Pieces. So you start to see the ways in which, why was that narrative necessary? I mean, you could have, you know, he's making stuff up. He might as well make up anything. Mm-hmm. But really, it tells you a story about where we are in terms of race.
Yeah. Well, why don't we close things out by asking you, you know, where we are, more broadly speaking, about this moment of, I mean, we are in an era that people are dubbing the post-fact era, an era where expertise is no longer seen as legitimate, and that, in like you say, that was sort of the language and of the, or the openness and the democratic aspect of the penny press in the 19th century. That was its promise, and the internet's promise was that too. But we're seeing the dark side of that. And how do we negotiate this moment and not lose complete any kind of faith in facts, objective news, because these are the things that really shape our ability to navigate in our world, to adopt policies, to vote a certain way, to envision a future of our republic. So is there any kind of takeaway you have on, other than identifying this problematic part of our culture?
How can we save our republic? Is that your question? How can we fix it all?
Yes, in 30 seconds or less.
Well, I think there's a few things all related. I mean, one is I do think that now the danger is that rather than in Barnum's day where you said, well, you too are an expert, anyone can be an expert, now there's a notion that no one is an expert. Experts don't matter. Mm-hmm. And I think that's quite chilling. At the same time, I think you see the power of journalism and the ways that, whether it's in movies or in real life, the effect of, say, the Me Too movement and journalists uncovering sexual misconduct by folks and really testifying and providing sources and all the things that journalists do, I think really can have effect on us. And I think that's important to note. I think as readers, as lovers of the world and the word, I think it's important for us to not become cynical because of the same way that I think a magician depends on sort of skeptics to get over. You know, it's like if you believed in magic and he showed you a magic trick, it doesn't really matter. But it's the people who are like, yeah, no, this is fake. And then they show you the magic trick and you can't figure it out. That's when I think it's the most dangerous. Oddly, I think cynicism leads to the most kinds of hoaxes. So I think like journalists, we should be skeptical and check our sources and think hard about where we're getting information from. But at the same time, I think we should, you know, try to see the best in each other. And it sounds a little corny, but sort of embrace that as a kind of truth rather than simply, you know, take all the good news and wipe it away and only believe the worst. that's how I think we can combat the hoax.
Yeah, and being aware of it and its many manifestations is a really useful thing, and your book certainly accomplishes that. Well, Kevin Young, thanks so much for talking to us at In the Past Lane. This has been a really interesting and wide-ranging conversation, and very timely as well. I mean, you started this book long before the rise of Trump as a presidential candidate and the emergence of the epithet fake news, and so the timing of the book is really, really important. So thanks for taking the time.
Thanks for having me.
Kevin Young is the author of Bunk, The Rise of Hoaxes, Humbugs, Plagiarists, Phonies, Post-Facts, and Fake News. Published by Grey Wolf Press. Okay, people, that's all for this episode of In the Past Lane. Thank you so much for tuning in. If you like what you've heard, please subscribe to this podcast at iTunes, Stitcher, or wherever you access your podcasts. And tell your friends about In the Past Lane. That really helps to bring in new listeners. For more information about the many things we talked about today, head over to our show page for this episode at inthepastlane.com. I also want to hear from you, so please send us your comments, questions, and suggestions via Twitter, Instagram, and our Facebook page. I'm In the Past Lane's host, Edward T. O'Donnell, your historian at large, reminding you that history explains our world. So let's pay attention to it. Thanks for listening. We hope you'll join us next time for another journey in the past lane. Hey, Lulu, care to tell us about a time you were taken in by a hoax?
If I told you, I'd have to kill you.
SBI, Snoring Beagle International.